Hi there and welcome to Microsoft Virtual Academy. Today you're with Andrew McMurray, Technical Evangelist for Microsoft Corporation working out of Australia, and today we're going to be talking about deploying your hybrid cloud. Just a few things we want to go through today. Deploying our hybrid cloud is all about looking at the Windows Azure pack, so we're going to talk very briefly about the goals of the Windows Azure pack. We'll look at the features that are available to us with the Windows Azure pack, and we'll do some demonstrations. Firstly, we'll look at demonstrating the consistent experience that you get between the public Windows Azure framework as well as the on-premises Windows Azure pack for Windows Server. And then after we've looked at that, we'll do a bit of a demo on virtual machines and also SQL databases as provisioned through the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server. So, just to begin with, really we have one goal when it comes to the Windows Azure pack, and that is consistency. The idea of deploying a hybrid cloud, generally speaking, means that you have some form of on-premises infrastructure, perhaps some infrastructure at a service provider, and also some infrastructure in the public cloud, such as in Windows Azure. And one of the things we want to really do with the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server is to provide you a consistent administration and a consistent tenant experience across that public cloud as well as the on-premises and service provider space. We really only want to have one tool that we use, one set of skills that we need to deal with, rather than having to learn System Center on one side, have to learn Windows Azure on the other side, and whatever administration tool our service provider might give us. We can provide you with a single tool that will give you everything you need to look after all three of those environments. And really this comes down to being consistent with our platform. You've probably heard our Cloud OS story a few times now, and the idea of the Cloud OS is essentially it's three major areas in which we can provide cloud technology. Firstly, on-premises in a private cloud environment, utilizing Windows Server, Hyper-V and System Center. The service provider environment using the Windows Azure pack and creating plans and so on and so forth, allowing you in there. And then finally, the public cloud in Windows Azure. The idea of having this consistent platform across all three of these environments is that it gives us a very flexible development environment. So I can choose to develop with the same APIs as I would in Windows Azure as I could in an on-premises or a service provider foundation. I get that unified management experience as well with a common identity and security framework, whether it be Windows Azure AD or whether it be our on-premises or service provider AD. And then finally, we get that integrated virtualization platform across the public cloud, on-premises and the service provider framework. The whole idea is having a consistent user experience, and this was really something we looked at when we were adding and producing our public cloud offerings in Windows Azure. The idea is that once we get used to utilizing Windows Azure, it should make sense for us to start bringing those types of services into a hosting provider platform or even into an on-premises platform, giving us that single experience, that single administrative, that single tenant experience across all three of those platforms. And this is what the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server gives us. Essentially, it gives us the same APIs and the same management framework that we use inside our public-facing Windows Azure, allowing us to deploy on a per-tenant basis websites, virtual machines, service management portal, as well as third-party services. If we have a look at the way Azure services on Windows Server actually works, what we can see on the right-hand side of the screen here is the public Windows Azure space. In Windows Azure, obviously, our main fabric controller is Hyper-V there, although we don't point that out specifically in this particular slide. And then sitting on top of that are the different services that we offer as part of Windows Azure. Things like websites, SQL Server databases, service bus, VM role, etc., etc. Above that, we have a service management API that is called through the self-service portal. And the self-service portal will be familiar to any of you that have a Windows Azure account. It's that portal you go into to create your websites, stand up your VMs from the gallery, pretty much anything you want to do inside Windows Azure. That particular self-service portal experience was really what we wanted to bring into the private cloud environment or the service provider environment, giving us the ability to essentially have a single interface into our hybrid cloud. You can see here that what we've done with the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server is we've given you the self-service portal experience. And not every single service we offer in Windows Azure will be available through the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server immediately. But as time goes on and new services are brought into Windows Azure, we will see the capability of distributing those into a private or service provider cloud come through to the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server as well. However, one specific piece we need to deal with is the tenant creation process, which of course is taken care of in a separate portal in Windows Azure. In the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, we provide a service administration experience as well. So the service administrator, whether they be a data center administrator on an on-premises environment, or whether they be an administrator in a service provider environment, can start creating user accounts, plans, service plans, and then allow people to log into those and utilize the objects that are available to that particular service plan. A good example of a service plan might be one that contains the ability to create virtual machine roles as well as SQL Server databases on a on-premises private cloud infrastructure. We can link a user account to that particular plan so that when that user logs into the self-service portal, they get the ability to create those objects through the management layer that is provided, same as Windows Azure, through, in this case, System Center 2012 SP1 with the Service Provider Foundation incorporated into that. For these plans, we can lock them down with quotas, ensuring that an end user can't do too much and can't utilize too many of our resources. Finally, we have workload portability and a consistent dev experience here when we take our learnings from Windows Azure and bring them to the on-premises or service provider environment through the Windows Server Azure pack for Windows Server. Just to give you a brief idea of the major steps involved in enabling self-service hybrid cloud, you can see here there are four major things that we need to do. Configuring the fabric, creating a cloud from the fabric, delegating that cloud to a self-service user, and then deploying resources. Now, in the slide we're currently looking at, this is really skewed towards more of a infrastructure as a service type creation, but the concepts are fairly stock standard across IaaS, across SQL Server, across websites as well. Finally, by utilizing the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, we can then, through a single API and a single portal management experience, create finished services such as websites, virtual machines, and even service bus for messaging across different applications. Okay, so what we want to do now is give you a bit of a demo of our Windows Azure consistent experiences. So the first thing we want to look at here is the experience that we get when we are in the public cloud. At the moment, you can see that I'm logged into a legitimate copy of Windows Azure. You can see I've gone to manage.windowsazure.com, and what we can see here are all of the services available to my particular subscription. You can see that I've created some websites here, some virtual machines have been created. There's even some cloud services created here as well. This is the interface that we're all familiar with when we're working with Windows Azure. You will notice that as time goes on, extra things get added to Windows Azure. Now what we want to do is start looking at our on-premise application of Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, or perhaps a service provider utilizing this pack as well. You can see here I get a very consistent interface, and here I can create setup, website clouds, VM clouds, service bus clouds. I can even set up user accounts and plans for people to utilize, customers of mine, once I allow them into this particular environment. So at the moment we're seeing the management interface for setting this up. You can see that I've created a plan called TED Demo Plan, and this particular plan can be subscribed to. I can create a user account, attach it to the plan, and then provide services that I've given to the plan to the users. You can see here that we've had a couple of signups already this week, and as we scroll down, the plan services available are virtual machines and SQL Server databases. So when I log into the interface, I'll be able to add those in. If we look at the definition of our virtual machine cloud here, you can see that we're communicating with an internal virtual machine manager server and connecting to one of the cloud objects. Once I've made that available to this particular plan, you can see that I have the ability to specify different usage limits. So if I want to, I can choose to create a quota of cores, RAM, storage, virtual networks. You can see here that I can allow certain networks to be available that are created inside VMM, as well as different hardware profiles and different templates, effectively creating a gallery of objects for my customers to create in this particular area. If we look inside Virtual Machine Manager itself and go into the Fabric tab, the Library tab, we can have a look at these templates that are available just as we see them inside the Plan section there. You can see our hardware profiles here as well, showing us that demo hardware profile available to us. So all of that information is coming straight back into this Plan section here. Particularly useful because I effectively have that one portal to use to get access to all that information. You can see that I have my SQL servers included here in this plan as well, and that allows me as a user to go and create SQL databases. You can see we have two subscriptions in this particular plan. These subscriptions are effectively user accounts that I create and attach to the plan, and we can see those user accounts here. Two particular customers have user accounts here. They may be internal customers or maybe customers of my service provider. Once these accounts are created, then the end user can log into the user side of the fence. When I create those accounts, I go into VMs and services and under tenants here, you will get the ability to see those particular accounts created inside VMM as well. So when I create them through the interface, they get instantiated inside VMM as tenants, effectively tenant administrator user roles with those particular user accounts added to them. The passwords are assigned directly to the user accounts. I can link those up to Windows Azure AD as well if I want to. So very nice, very consistent interface here into the on-premises or service provider side of the fence, as well as everything else. If I want to create myself a new user account, it's very simple. I just choose user account, quick create, or I can even do the same thing with plans as well. You can see all through this very consistent creation capabilities here, creating VM clouds, creating SQL servers, all done through this interface, similar to what I would do inside Virtual Machine Manager. Okay, so now that we've seen the consistent experiences between the public cloud and our Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, let's have a look at some of the cloud offerings that we make available through the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, similar to what I would get inside the public cloud Windows Azure. So specifically looking at websites, service bus, and virtual machines. When it comes to websites, essentially what we can do with the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server is create highly scalable web applications utilizing integrated source control with TFS or GitHub, manage our app with real-time telemetry, so looking at the monitoring section here, seeing exactly how many hits we're getting, what type of results we're getting back. We can quickly and easily scale that up or down simply by telling the interface how many instances of this particular website we want. One of the great things too is we get support for .NET, Node.js, PHP and Python, so we're not locking you down into utilizing one form of programming language. In terms of service bus is a messaging service for cloud applications, essentially giving us a guaranteed message delivery from one aspect of your application to the other in a publish subscribe messaging pattern using standard protocols such as REST, AMQP, and WS, whatever, WS management, etc., etc. Interoperable with .NET, Java, C, C++, and integrated into the management portal as well. With virtual machines, when we hook up our Windows Azure a pack for Windows Server with System Center 2012 Virtual Machine Manager, we get the ability to create and remove virtual machines in a very similar, consistent way than we do with IaaS inside Windows Azure. Essentially allowing us to connect into Virtual Machine Manager, choose which templates we want to work with in a gallery form, and get the ability to produce either Windows or Linux virtual machines depending on what's been made available to me through Virtual Machine Manager. Additionally, I get the ability to create virtual networks either connected to supplied networks inside Virtual Machine Manager or even creating site-to-site connectivity, and I can supply my own IP addresses there in the tenant section of that particular capability as well. So what we want to do now is have a quick demo of how to create a virtual machine through the Windows Server pack for Windows Azure pack for Windows Server. Okay, so here we are in the tenant side of the fence. I'm logged in as my tenant to the service management portal, and I'm going to create myself a virtual machine utilizing the connection between the Windows Server, Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, and Virtual Machine Manager through the System Center 2012 Service Provider Foundation. Just like I would on Windows Azure, I'll click New, I'll choose Standalone Virtual Machine, and notice when I click Gallery, I get access to all of the different templates that I have access to in VMM. Very standard stuff here. What I'm going to do is choose to do a quick create rather than a gallery. I'll choose the template that I need, again similar to what I saw in the gallery before, and put in a computer name here, and I'm going to create a name of Ted Test VM. Put in a password for the local administrator account, and then click Create VM Instance. What we now do is we hand off a request to the Service Provider Foundation, which then passes that request to VMM. If we go into our VMM console now and look at our running jobs, you'll see already we've got a Create Virtual Machine in a Cloud job running. It's already created the skeleton of the virtual machine, and now it's deploying the VHD for the purposes of creating that virtual machine for me. So as you can see, in just a couple of clicks, looking exactly the way it looks inside Windows Azure, we now have an on-premises VM creating through Virtual Machine Manager. In terms of additional services that we have available to us through the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, in terms of identity, we have the ability to interact with Active Directory and ADFS, as well as create co-administrators. With database services, we can create SQL Server databases or MySQL databases on Linux servers. And we can also develop our own custom services using the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server SDK available for any service provider. All right, so last demo we want to do today is just give you an idea of how we can create SQL Server databases through the Windows Azure pack. Again, here I am in the tenant portal of the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server, and this time we're going to create a SQL database. Very, very simple stuff. I can choose to add a new database here, or I can jump in through my standard menu, looking very similar to what I get inside the public cloud Windows Azure environment. I'll choose to create a new database, and this particular database will be called Wow App, and I'm going with our default edition here. And now I can put in my admin name for the database. Put in Macca here. Put a password in. Like so. Click OK. Now, simple as that, it goes off and adds this particular database into my SQL environment. Very, very simple. Very, very easy. Just like what we get in Windows Azure. Okay, so that's our very short segment for today. Our key takeaways really are that we want to show you and we want you to be aware that the Windows Azure pack for Windows Server essentially gives us a almost identical interface to Windows Azure's public cloud administrative and tenant experience, allowing us as either a service provider or even an on-premises data center administrator to provide cloud-enabled services in an identical experience to my customers as and when needed, giving us cloud OS consistency across all our clouds, whether they be the public cloud, the hosting provider cloud, or even an on-premises cloud. One of the great things about this particular technology is we're taking investments made in Windows Azure, bringing that both to on-premise and hosted clouds, but also as we create new technologies on-premises and in hosted clouds, we can then feed that back into the public cloud as well. Hopefully you've enjoyed today's very short podcast. Here's a couple of things for you to check out: the TechNet Evaluation Center, TechNet Virtual Labs, and of course, MVA. And just remains for me to say, thanks very much for listening. See you later.